Thank you, first of all, all of you for being with us here at this time, at this place. We, as promised, we have our VIP guests over here. We have Suthankar, ex-commissioner. We have Ravi Raja, opposition leader. And the leader of the house has been summoned to Mantralaya based upon his arraignment at and over there. We do not know when he'll be back, but we start the program accordingly. Should we start the program? Yes, thank you very much. We are on schedule now. First of all, I will request young ladies over there, Mr. Suthankar, please accept our token of love from us. Please join your hand, put your hands together. Thank you very much. Then we have Ravi Raja, who is here with us. He has obliged us very much by coming here to enjoy the opportunity. We have also a renowned personality over here, Rafael. Rafael, please take it back to come a little further so that he is talking to you. You know, this leader is happening, everyone knows it so very well right now. We also have Nikhil. Nikhil is the star of Agni and very much versatile. Nikhil, please come from. We want you to come. Everybody must see the good work you have been doing for the country and the country. Please come up here. We have Harshal among us. Harshal, please come little forward. We want you to come forward. And he's the United Christian Forum leader over there. He's the secretary over there. He's doing good work in Mumbai. Then we have Robin Rao, he is from Christi Samaj, Vikas Manch. Please come forward, my dear friend, Robin Rao. He is also doing very good work in this field, and we would like to thank you. We have Lewis, Dr. Lewis. He has been a university lecturer of politics from the old times. He is a great initiator of Bombay Catholic Sabha president. That's a long, long time. Dr. Lewis, please.
Yes.
And we have Bento from Bombay Catholic Sabha. He has always been with us and we are very thankful to him. Bento, please come forward. Thank you very much. And now to begin with, we will be starting with Ravi Raja. Ravi Raja, from his youth time, he has been a very active social worker, volunteer, politics, everything. And the record, 5 times elected corporator. Please put your hands together. Being the Congress leader, the opposition leader, definitely he will be guiding the destiny of BMC with all this thought processes, coordination. We will request now Ravi Raja to give us your presentation as how you are going to take this BMC Municipal Corporation from 2017 to 2022. How will you make it run and what will be the benefit the people to expect from this Municipal Corporation? Thank you.
Church in the city has invited me for interaction regarding the future 5 years plan of the city of Mumbai. I think I am sitting in front of a very senior, you can say a father figure of Maharashtra and Mumbai, Mr. Suthankar, who has been a chief secretary, who has been a municipal commissioner, who was secretary in the urban development, and other distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to that after many years, I am meeting Mr. Suthankar, and yes, while I was talking to him, but I think he's got still the zest is there and the will is there, and we need people like Mr. Suthankar to guide us and to take the city forward. Regarding the next 5 years, as you know that recently there was a municipal election, and in that election the ruling party who is in the corporation is the Shiv Sena, and the second party is the BJP, and third party is the Congress party. Now I will also let you know that how I became the leader of the opposition. That is very important, because in the BMC Act, any party which comes second in the election has to take the responsibility of leader of the opposition. But in this case, the BJP, who was the second largest party, they refused to take the leader of the opposition. So the mayor took a decision that in the democracy, vibrant democracy, we should have a leader of the opposition. So they gave to a person, third person, third party. So third party being the largest, so I became the leader of the opposition. So leader of the opposition, as Mr. I was discussing with Mr. Suthankar, in today's scenario in the corporation, leader of the opposition plays a very important role. Why? Because as everybody is aware that the first and second party are fighting among themselves. So leader of the opposition has to play a very important role. Now next 5 years, what I understand is the utmost important is the development plan which is pending with the corporation. The development plan of the from 1914 to 1934. Already we are delayed by more than 3 years. The development plan has been submitted by the planning authority, where the committee was formed, of 6-member committee was formed by the government. After the suggestion and the objection, what I understand was there was nearly 80,000 suggestion and objection. Some were personally, some were from the organization, some was from the NGO, some was from the central government. So what I understand is that they, from 80,000, many people were having the common, you know, the objections were common. So they bought it to 12,000, and in that 12,000, after the suggestion and objection, the 6-member committee, Mr. Jha, Mr. Gautam Chatterjee, and 3 from the corporation, they finalized that and sent it to the corporation, given to the mayor in March 6th they have given. And when it came to the house in the month of March 19th, the corporation, that the, all the corporators were new, so they wanted to study and they asked for 2 months extension. So 2 months extension gets expires in May 16th. Now as you understand that development plan for city of Mumbai is very important. All the new corporators are trying to learn or coming to know the terms that what exactly is the development plan. Today, out of 227 corporators, 165 corporators are new first time. They have been elected for the first time. So as you understand, to understand the corporation, to understand the act, it requires time. And lot of expectations are there from the people of Mumbai. As my role being the opposition, I would like to first of all state that the DP has to be very transparent, it has to be very clear, it has to be such a way that it benefits the people of Mumbai. In this DP, what I understand, and the presentation was made to the about a week back to the councillors by Mr. Gautam Chatterjee and Mr. Jha. When the presentation was made, some questions were asked, you know, why this open space was reserved, why the PG, RG, gardens, you know, and all these places are being, you know, in some places it has been converted. One glaring example I would like to state, as everybody knows, the RA colony. Today that area is, I think, more than it might be 300-400 acres, you know, it's a greenery in city of Mumbai. But what I understand is that they have proposed, the government has proposed a car shed in the area of RA. Nearly 25% of that area will be converted into a car shed for the metro. So when Mr. Gautam Chatterjee was, you know, explaining to us, I got up and said, why do you want this car shed in RA only? So he said, see, it is the decision of the government. It's up to you now. It has come to the corporation. Now corporators can decide. They can make changes. So we have taken a stand as a Congress party and as opposition have taken a stand that we will not allow car shed in RA colony. That's very, very clear about it. I'm very clear about it. And we are also going through other recommendations made by the planning committee. There are some places where they have tried to convert the recreation ground. From the Congress party, we are very clear that no PG, no RG, no any greenery area will be allowed to convert into any other user. This is very clear from the Congress party. And we are going to oppose it. Our number might be less, but we have got a strong willpower to see that, because today our numbers are the deciding factor between the two parties. Second thing is, as you know, that recently there was a scam in the BMC for the work done for the desilting, you know, cleaning of the big drains and all that. That was a scam of the roads. So, in this, I would like to clearly state, I have clearly specified that any contractor who has been blacklisted or any contractor who has been, he has gone to jail, he should not be given work in the municipal corporation. That is very clear. And second thing, we are not concerned with the company, because what happens, once the company is blacklisted, they come with the other name. We have clearly stated that the blacklisted, the company should be blacklisted, and the owner of the company should also be blacklisted, so that tomorrow he doesn't go to any form other company and come inside the corporation. That is very clear, and we are very clear about it. Regarding, as you understand, the budget, I think Mr. Suthankar is the father figure. He has been the commissioner of Mumbai Corporation. Our budget, which was around 35,000 crores, 37,000 crores last year, they have pulled it down to 25,000 crores. Nearly 12,000 crores has been pulled down by the present commissioner. Now, when we asked, they said because of the, you know, some capital expenditure or the capital revenue has to be, you know, adjusted. So, but I clearly said that the capital expenditure, when you are going to give it to the city of Mumbai, when that is drastically cut, I think that will really pinch the people of Mumbai. Today, if the roads are not, there was sufficient budget last year for the roads, but I think today more than 40% of the budget has been cut for the road. Same if you see with the cement concrete, same if you see the cleaning of the drains, making of the drains, making of the gardens, all, you know, this area, the budget has been cut, wherein I have taken a stand that the budget should not be cut when directly it is going to affect to the Mumbaikers. That stand is very clear. Now, other thing is that you might have read in the newspaper, Mumbai is one of the richest corporation in India. And I got really, you know, when in the first meeting only, we came to know that there are 62,000 crores which are kept in fixed deposit in the banks. Physically it is kept in the banks. So when you got so much money with you, why can't you take that money and spend for the people of Mumbai? My direct question to the commissioner was, when you got so much money in the bank, I think the next step should be that the taxes should be reduced. Why are you not reducing the taxes? Why are you not reducing the taxes? Why can't you give a better life to the people of Mumbai? And the most important thing is the cutting of the trees. We are totally against it. We are totally against it. I think there is a authority called tree authority. First of all, I would like to state that that tree authority should be totally abolished. It should be abolished. Why? Because all the proposal for the cutting of tree goes to that authority. And who is the chairman of the tree authority is the commissioner. Why should we allow? Today, they are saying that we are cutting 5,500 trees, 500 trees, and you are saying that replanting, replantation of 1,000 trees. But where are you going to replant? How is it possible? Who is going to see it? Everybody sees that it's getting cut down. And when you want to replant, nobody sees it. And today, what is the reason for the climate change? This is because of the cutting of the trees, and people are playing with the environment, with the nature. When you play with the nature will play with you. So that's what's happening now. If you see, I have never seen in my life, because I am brought up in Bombay, I am born in Bombay. In the month of March, it was very hot. Every time, when summer comes in the month of April 15th, and it goes till May. But if you see in the month of March, it has been too hot. Why? Because this is because of the lack of trees and lack of greenery. Everywhere, what you see, there is cementization of the place. In this DP, I have seen that there is an FSI of 8 FSI. Where will you go? What is the infrastructure? How is it possible? You don't have planning for the sewerage. You don't have the planning for the roads. You don't have planning for the drinking water. So I think the time has come that we should restrict the FSI in Mumbai. We should restrict it. Otherwise, after 10 years, it will be very difficult to stay in the city of Mumbai. There are many people who are really, in city of Mumbai, who want that the city should look beautiful. If you see now, Mahalakshmi Race Course, I think Mr. Suthankar sahab knows it. It's a greenery. See, race course, 365 days, the race is not going on. But it's a greenery. Now, there is a proposal there that should be converted to a theme park. Now, when theme park comes, then the restaurant comes, then everything else comes. What happens to the greenery? Such a wonderful place we got in Worli. So we are against that also. We are against that. And I would like to state that being in opposition, as an effective opposition, we will see, I will particularly see that if they, Shiv Sena or the ruling party, does anything against the people of Mumbai, we will be there to oppose it, and we will see that whatever policy they are making, it will be opposed by the people of Mumbai, and we will take the support of people of Mumbai. The agenda of corporation is equal to many states. I think nowhere in the world, such corporation exists where a baby is born or till the person dies. Everything is run by the corporation. Birth certificate. If you see the schools, corporation is providing schools to the, I think, 4.5 lakh students are there. Then we have got parks. We are having hospitals. We are running big hospitals in city of Mumbai. We have got our own medical education colleges. We have got B.Ed. Colleges. So if you see the work done by the corporation, and on that we are also running the transport system. We are running the electricity also, we give electricity also. So if you see, everything is done by the corporation. Even the transport, today you might have read in the paper, the BST. I have been in the BST committee for last 18 years. Today the BST committee, BST administration, the transport system has gone to doldrums. It's gone to doldrums, the verge of closing it down. Why? because of the mismanagement. Mismanaged, not properly, fund has been utilized. So, the corporation's responsibility is there. Because the BST is a part of the corporation. The BST undertaking budget has to be approved by the corporation. But corporation is not ready to give a single paisa for the best undertaking. Recently we had a talk. I had a talk with the commissioner in the group leaders meeting. I said, why you want to, I know that, you know, transport undertaking anywhere in the world or anywhere in India is doesn't run on a profit. We are giving service. Corporation or a BST undertaking is not under the Companies Act. We are a social, you can say, obligatory duty of the corporation to have this type of services. There are 18 types of services where it's obligatory, has to be done by the corporation. And one of these is the transport. So we had a talk with the commissioner. I said, you subsidize the transport system. Just raising the ticket is not the solution to it. So I think there's a talk going on that somewhere the corporation, the budget of the BST will be merged with the budget of the corporation. So that is the one aspect going on. Other thing is the water. As you see today, the population of Mumbai is increasing day by day. We have got projects. Mid-Vaitarna is there. Gargai project is there. In that project, lot of money has been spent. But always when the election comes, they will say that, you know, 24/7, we will provide water. I don't think anybody is getting more than 1 hour, 2 hours of water. No, nobody gets water. So that planning has to be done by the corporation. There has been few years, you know, I would like to say that we need people like Mr. Suthankar in the corporation as a commissioner so that the citizen will have a proper way of life. I mean to say that today Suthankar can't go and sit there, but at least his expertise should be taken by the present commissioner. His knowledge, who has worked, his expertise and other thinking has to be, thought process has to be done by the present commissioner. I spoke of the water, about the health. Health, today I had a talk with the Dean of the Science Hospital. He said, Mr. Raja, every year I am getting 20 lakh patients. 20 lakh patients every year. KM is saying 18 lakh patients. These hospitals not only cater to city of Mumbai, where there are people coming from Assam also. When somebody comes from Assam, when he enters San Hospital, he has been given treatment. From Kashmir, from Kanyakumari. Our budget of the health is not less than 4,500 crores. Education budget is around 4,000 crores. So this has to be, we are spending so much, but the quality of the life of city of Mumbai has to be improved. And as an effective opposition, I will see, it is my thought process that wherever the ruling party does some mistake, it is my duty bound to see that it is brought to the notice of the ruling party. And if they are not doing good work, it is my duty bound to see that I oppose that policy. So I will not take much of your time, but definitely I would like to state that as an effective opposition, the responsibility given by me, by the party and by the people. I will work effectively and for the betterment of the people, and I would like to thank Mr. Sirsat for inviting me and making me present among our ex-Chief Secretary and ex-Mr. Commissioner, Mr. Suthankar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for outlining what are the main issues. जो आपने बताया गया है कि कार्यशेष के बारे में के contractors है, budget के बारे में, trees authority, BST bus, और अंत में आपने बताया कि इसका शब्द मूल्य ये अंत होना चाहिए, कारण होना चाहिए, quality of life should be better for us. I think if that is understood by each leader, much can happen in Mumbai. We count on you for a powerful opposition and surely carrying the voice of our people. Thank you, sir. Call upon Sir Suthankar. Yeah. You may choose to sit or stand, sir. Yeah?
No, you can choose. And I'm absolutely fighting fit. No, why he is saying it is because about a month back I was down with pneumonia and I recovered fully thanks to the modern antibiotics and the kind of medical treatment which is now available.
Just one second, sir.
Hello? Are you hearing me? Yeah. As a matter of fact, Suthankar needs no introduction. For more than 3 to 4 decades, I think, am I right, sir? For more than 4 decades, he has been at the service of all of us. He has been the Chief Secretary of the Government of Maharashtra. He has been leading many commissions and organizations. And he has been our ex-commissioner for a long time. And over and again and over and again, I have drawn inspiration from you, sir, all the time. You could see that. Sir, now for last more than a decade also, he is being with citizens. He is the president of Agni. No other organization is the best. And your organization, Agni, is leading Agni from the front. So, thank you very much, sir. Please, the mic is yours now.
Respected father, my colleague in Agni, Mr. Vinis Shirsar. There are several Agni coordinators to be seen in the audience. And ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, the leader of the house is not here. And not being a political animal myself, I cannot really fill that gap. I think some few months back, there was a similar congregation meeting here. When, how do you propose to transform Mumbai was the topic for discussion. And at that time, political leaders of different parties had come and had presented their vision as to what they propose to do in order to transform Mumbai into a modern city, into a more benign city for the citizens, etc. But my impression of today's meeting is that we are not again discussing the same thing. In the sense, what are the contents of the development plan? These are important things, but I don't want to again go into the same details, same features. As a neutral, politically neutral person belonging once upon a time to the civil service, I would like to tell you more about the process of governance in the BMC. That is, whatever may be the decisions which are ultimately taken and later on implemented, what is the process of formulation of certain proposals, examination of those proposals, the pros and cons, the financial implications, how much it is going to cost, what are the administrative implications, do we have the kind of personnel which is required for implementing the decision, should we take that decision? All these aspects are required to be studied before you decide to do a particular thing, either as a matter of development or as a matter of maintaining something, of maintaining the existing institutions, etc., etc. So when we talk of governance, we are referring to the entire gamut of activities, right from the time a certain proposal is formulated till the time it is budgeted for and implemented. This entire process is the process of governance. Governance is different from government. Government is an institution. And the local self-government, the third tier of government, central, state, and the municipal corporation, the third tier of government. These are institutions which are endowed with powers and also corresponding responsibilities in certain areas as provided by the Constitution. They are supposed to do certain things. What is their jurisdiction? What are the things on which they can legislate? And what will be the process of implementation of the decisions taken? Broadly has been laid down in the Indian Constitution and later on in individual laws which are formulated. And take for example the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act. It talks about, as was being mentioned by Mr. Raja, it talks about certain obligatory duties, certain discretionary duties, and how these duties will be performed, what are the constraints, in what manner you will have to proceed, what kind of regulatory permissions will have to be imposed on the people who want to do development because it falls within the private sector or the individual sector. So that, as was mentioned, environment is not adversely affected. So that there are no risks to life and property. Now all these things have been laid down in the BMC Act. And the process of governance, as I said, has to begin with the formulation of proposals, getting them examined till they are implemented. And in this entire process, both the elected representatives as well as the administration, the bureaucracy, contributes in the process of formulation, in the process of approval of the decisions, and in the process of final implementation, where, as elected representatives, they also act along with the members of the public as watchdogs of what is being implemented is really in consonance with what was planned, what was proposed, or there is some leakage, or there is some failure in the process of implementation. So the point I'm trying to make is that this is a complex process, cannot be described within a matter of a few minutes, or maybe I may take a full hour, but even then I may not be able to enter into all the nitty-gritty of this entire process. But over a period of time, irrespective of what the responsibilities and duties of that particular level of government is, now it is being realized after a lot of debate, consultation, interaction with the members of the public, that the process of governance, if it has to be a benign process in public interest, if it has to be a process which promotes public welfare and gives confidence to the people that what is ultimately being delivered is what they aspire for or what will fulfill their needs, then only when one can talk about it as good governance. So what are the attributes, what are the features of good governance? Any process of governance to be called good, are there any features, are there any attributes, are there any requirements which are required to be fulfilled? And that is what I am going to concentrate on. Because I cannot go into your manifesto, whether it is good, bad, because as I said, in politics you can have different views, different manifestos, but I am not in that process of deciding what is good development plan or bad development plan, or whether a particular project or scheme should have been there, whether this reservation should have been there or not. That is something which you can debate. And you will debate. I am only going to talk about the salient features of any process of governance. If it aspires to be called good governance, what is it that it has to fulfill? And here, I might, perhaps some of you might have read that when the Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister, he passed away, I forget his name now. He was the Chief Minister. He said that the process of governance to be called good governance can be described as smart. Nowadays everything is smart. You know, smart card, smart this, smart that. But smart, he mentioned as a kind of an acronym, S-M-A-R-T. Now each of these letters stands for something, some attribute, some feature. If it is fulfilled by the process of governance, then the process can be considered or can qualify itself to be called good governance. Otherwise, it can be dictatorial, it can be bad, it can be anti-people, etc., etc. But if it has to be good governance, it has got to fulfill certain requirements. Now, what is smart? S, to begin with. Simple. Actually, S stands for simple. In the sense that this entire complex process of decision making, formulating proposals, final approval, etc., etc., if it is as simple as possible for people to be able to understand. Now many of you, and even before I entered the portals of municipal corporation, I used to myself wonder how this huge machine works. How does it function? And if this complexity of the process of governance is so overwhelming that people feel bewildered, then I think it's not a good thing. Ultimately, the people who are being governed must understand how they are being governed. And what is the goal, what are the objectives to be achieved? Therefore, what S stands for is try and simplify your process of governance to certain basic elements which can be understood by the people. Now this is of course easier said. There are some complexities in every process, and not that every process is something which every Tom, Dick and Harry in the public can understand. But nevertheless, one should attempt at consciously making this whole process as simple as possible. And M now, the next letter, M stands for, you'll be surprised, M stands for moral. The process must be ethical. The process must be such that it doesn't have any evil in it, anything intrinsically bad in it, anything which is considered to be dishonest, corrupt, or anything of the kind. It should be something which fulfills the notion of morality, of right and wrong, and therefore M stands for moral. A stands for accountable. When you take a decision, people have a right to know why the hell did you take that decision. And you must be able to explain to the people, and you must hold yourself responsible for the outcome of that decision. You cannot say the decision, take the decision, and then blame the bureaucracy or the contractor and this and that. In actual practice, the fault may lie with some cog in the wheel. But nevertheless, you must take the responsibility. This is what the British had as a tradition. If there was a railway accident, the general manager was not sacked. It is the railway minister who resigned. And therefore, the buck must stop somewhere. So, the accountability means for every action, for every decision that is taken by the governance process in actual practice, somebody has to be accountable for it. You cannot point the finger to somebody else, no, I don't know. I only nodded my head, it is XYZ who was actually in charge. That won't do. It has, that accountability is very, very important. Then R means responsive. Responsive to the needs of the people, to the aspirations of the people. Therefore, even the development plan, does it reflect the aspirations of the people? Is it effective enough to fulfill the genuine needs of the people over the next 15 or 20 years that this plan is going to remain in operation? These are the kinds of questions which ought to be asked. And of course, nothing can ultimately fulfill all your requirements and aspirations, because all that will depend upon what the aspirations are, what are the resources that you have, whether you can fulfill to what extent. But the attempt should be to optimize the level of satisfaction. And therefore, along with accountability, there must be responsiveness. That if, as was mentioned by Mr. Raja, if the people really feel that RA colony should not be touched, let us say, and that is the unanimous opinion, more or less, and if some other alternative can be found, and if honest and concerted effort is made to find it, that effort must be made. Government has taken the decision is not the answer. With due respect to Mr. Chatterjee, he has been my junior colleague. The government or anybody who took that decision has got to be able to explain why that decision was taken. That is accountability. And therefore, responsiveness to the needs problems, aspirations of the people is another important requirement which the process of governance has to fulfill if it has to be labeled as good governance. Otherwise, it won't qualify for being called good governance. And finally, the word transparency, T. And transparency just now was referred to, that you cannot, don't take me politically, but many decisions they say are taken in Matoshri, or they are taken in maybe the chief minister's residence, whatever it is, Varsha. That is not the way. It must be transparent in the sense that you must be able to take the people into confidence that these are the things I consider. And after taking into account both the pros and cons, the cost and the probable outcome, I took this decision. You may or may not agree. That's a totally different story, because on everything there can be differences of opinion. But at least I must be able to explain why the hell I took that decision. What were the compelling reasons? In what manner that decision is going to maximize public interest? Because you are dealing here with not your private money, but money raised from the taxes and from the pockets of the people. And therefore you are accountable to the people. And you must be in a position to explain to the people why you took such a decision. For example, penguins were bought. Who took the decision? Why was the decision taken? I don't know. Was it really worth spending 8 crores of rupees or whatever for that beautiful old habitat which has been 40 crores? So, maybe even perhaps more, and the maintenance. Now, these are questions which will be asked, and therefore the hush-hush manner in which decisions are taken do not manifest a process of good governance. They manifest a process of something which is being done according to the whim and fancy of the people. Of the people who took the decision, or to line their own pockets, or to favor some contractor or some other person involved. That should not happen. People must know why a decision was taken. And I have lately, with my experience, added 2 more letters which can't go with smart. And those are A for accessibility. That is, government, the process of governance and those who govern must be accessible. To get into Mantralaya is difficult, maybe for right security reasons. But forget the security part, which can be, I have been, for example, sorry for the slight diversion, recently there was an incident of attack in the British Parliament. A few years back, I had an occasion to go to London for some work, and I wanted to go and see how the parliament functions, how the debate goes on. You wouldn't believe, within 10 minutes, I could get permission to enter the Westminster. Don't they have security? So, what I'm trying to say is, unless there is accessibility, unless people feel that those who are taking decisions on my behalf are there with their ears open and eyes open, so that if I have a grievance, somebody will listen to me and it will not be a cry in wilderness. Therefore, accessibility in a good democratic form of government. And that is what we espouse, and we hope we are practicing. The accessibility of people who govern, who operate the process of governance, is very important. And finally, Last letter is P, participative. That people's participation in the entire process of governance is also very important. That is why now the new ideas of social audit, people being consulted before any decision is taken. There are public hearings held before a complicated decision is taken, so that at least you get to know how the people are thinking about it, what are their reactions. And having taken that into account, having given them a chance to participate both in the formulation of proposal, in the decision making process directly or indirectly, and finally at the time of implementation. If members of the public can act as your watchdogs, the contractor will be little more alert that somebody will come and ask me, ye kaam kab shuru hua, kab band hone wala hai, board is supposed to be put but nobody puts it. Now things of that kind. Therefore public participation is also equally important, and that these are some of the attributes of governance which a good governance must fulfill. Whether the people in power belong to Shiv Sena or the BJP or the Congress or any other party, if they adhere to these principles, these features, then only they will be in a position to deliver good governance. And while the people, all their hopes and aspirations may not be fulfilled, at least they will have the satisfaction that they were taken into confidence, that an honest effort was made to involve them in the process of governance. Their views were taken, and in what way they can contribute or in what way they can exercise their vigilance over the process of governance also was taken into account. And therefore I commend to those newly elected members of our corporation to ponder on this, to ponder on these. Maybe it may appear to you as some very highly philosophical kind of concepts that I have talked about. They are not as philosophical and as verbose as they might have appeared. But in every little decision, in every little proposal, in every little implementation, if these principles are taken into account and are practiced, we will get good governance, whether in the corporation or in the state government or in the panchayat or wherever the level of governance is. Thank you very much.
Acronym of good governance, and rightly you have mentioned that we need not go into the manifesto, but if one understands the process of governance and keeps to it, whichever party is in power, we can do wonders. Thank you so much for your beautiful talk on this issue. There will be a few questions allowed. Sir has to go. Yeah. So just few questions, Nelson, one on this side, then someone on that side.
Yeah. Keep that.
Is it a question?
Yes, sir. No. Give one more chair.
Get the mic there. That mic. That mic. Give it to you.
You start.
So I don't have a question, but have something for beneficial for all of us. And I request sir to take up this matter very seriously. There's a big scam going on. Just 2 months back, I was checking the bills of assessment tax and water bills, where the BMC is charging us civil tax in both of them. So I applied for inquiry and asked for a refund. I got a huge amount of so many years. You all can go in all your past bills and ask them. It's a big scam. I hope you can take up this matter. It must go in crores or rupees. Nobody must be knowing that. Civil taxes, they charge an assessment bill also, and also in the water bills, which is everybody doesn't know that, but the BMC knowingly they do that. So it's a big thing. Please,
yeah.
It's a very big thing. It's a scam. I'm also willing to take up in a PIL, and it is going to come in the news everywhere. It's a big thing, I'm telling.
Thanks, Nelson.
So please,
we have any question from this corner here? That lady over here, your question, please come. Those who have questions, kindly come forward so that we can save time. Yeah, go forward, sir, madam. Go for a little forward.
My question or my suggestion is that corruption and on educational level and in the hospitals, if that can be brought to control, it would make it would relieve us from lot of trouble and give us peace.
Okay, yeah. So sir will answer totally once we have 3-4 and then he has to leave. Anyone else? Municipal hospital?
Yes.
Any hospital, okay. Madam over there, yes, come forward if you have a question, because then we can save time. Anyone from this side? Come this side, please.
Yeah. Very good evening, praise the Lord. My question is, wonderful, the procedure was beautiful, well said, smart classes and smart things which we are doing today, and sir also had beautifully said it, but who's going to bell the cat? We are all here, we are asking for some kind of a difference. We are here to ask for a difference. Who's going to listen to our voice and who's going to do it? The procedure is beautiful, but who's going to follow that? And who's going to give an answer for what we want?